Okay, this is the April Finance Committee meeting. Chair Steve Miller, if we go around and introduce attendees.
Julie Olofsson.
Greg Cooper.
We have a...
Kathy Lee.
Rob Hurley.
Okay, we have a pretty light agenda again for tonight. It's really two items. One is to review information for the budget, to see where we are, and it's getting ready, making sure that we're ready for the workshop coming up next week. And there was one other item. What was the other item, Kathy?
Insurance, we're changing insurance carriers for life insurance.
Changing life insurance carriers. Okay. So you sent out a spreadsheet with some budget information. Do we want to walk through that?
Absolutely. I have it up on the board.
Okay.
The first tab I sent it's got three tabs on it. It's the revenue, the expenditures, and the fund balance analysis.
Okay.
What we're doing here is we're specifically looking at where I'm projecting that we're going to fall at the end of 2021. The first tab being revenue, I walked through the local revenue, and you're seeing very detailed. I did it by account, so you see every single account on here. We did come in a little bit higher than what I had projected. Collection rate, as I've been reporting, has been a little bit better than what we were projecting. So, stop if you see anything that you have questions about. There's the earned income tax, there's the transfer tax, there's delinquents per capita. It goes all the way through all the taxes.
Mm-hmm.
And you go down into earnings on investments, admissions, and the type of revenue that we get from like student parking and all the like athletic type of things from the admissions and insurance tax.
Okay, so you're forecasting it's a total of $59,153,000.
Yeah.
Okay. I saw there were two TBD items with audit proceeds from the bond refund.
The what?
Near the bottom, the proceeds from, I guess.
Oh, to be the, okay.
Yeah.
I don't do the debt entry to the audit or sale.
Okay.
That's like, and that kind of like throws the whole financials off. If you notice back in 1920, we had that debt refi where the $19 million comes in. It kind of makes things a little bit, so I didn't even include it, but if you like take the $19 million off, just for comparison's sake.
Okay.
Second section, I went from local revenue, which is your 6,000, then you have your 7,000, which is your state revenue. State revenue, I am anticipating pretty much everything's on target from what we have projected. A little bit higher in some areas, but not on the bus. The one thing I want to point out is that they've already started because of all the federal funding, even though the state's going to come in and try to take money from them. They already started that by reducing our aid ratio. So they came out last week as a surprise to everyone. They decided that they're going to recalculate the aid ratio that we get for transportation fees or plan time and Social Security. So there's about $7 million in those categories. You combine them all together. The old aid ratio was 0.5748, not significant, but now the new one is 0.5727. So on that revenue amount, it's probably about $14,000-$15,000 that they're not going to be getting as a surprise at the end of the year. We're going to go back and take it. And a heads up, there has been a lot of talk about that money to learn grant. That's always been the top of the town coming off the table. So I'm not sure where we're going to end up or what they're going to shortcut us later on coming up this 2 week term. These are the numbers I'm coming up with right now. Down in federal, We did get some of the funding in for 19-20. We used up some of the funding, not a lot of it, but you'll see it in the projections when we do the budget on the committee of the budget workshop. I have all the funding that I know of 2 weeks in that budget presentation. So you can see all the different categories, like there's the years of COVID revenue, there's FEMA, that's still to be determined. I'm working with them this week and next week probably, so I can kind of fine-tune those numbers now that we've got all of our other grant money kind of put in these little boxes. I can go back and see what's left. There's the years, there's ESSER-1, ESSER-2, and this is a pretty, if you look down at the budget presentation, which you guys will see a little bit later on, we do have a significant amount of money coming in. I have this on the 5-year. Above the screen there, you see like the ESSER-2 money. There's a one-time hit there. The ESSER-3 money, which we're going to take over 2 years, is going to be here and here. And then it drops off. So when you're looking at your total revenues, so I do have this in our 5-year plan. So when we're going over this in the budget workshop,
okay,
we'll be able to see what that looks like. And I'll set this out in advance too.
Okay. Yep.
All right, now back to this year. This is where I'm projecting. There's still some numbers that are tweaking a little bit, but projecting $59.1 million coming in there, and then you go into the expenditure tab. Again, stop me if you have any questions on any of these numbers. You have the first section, which are your 100. This kind of breaks it out for you to tell you what's in those categories. So if you're all your salary accounts, your extra duty pay, anyone that gets paid a salary that is W-2 with us is in that category. The next section going down, I'd say, is pretty much the budget right there. We budget paid after it being there. The next section is the 200, which is all your benefits. So anybody that gets a W-2, these are all the benefits that they get paid from Social Security, retirement, tuition reimbursement. There's workers' comp in there, there's medical insurance, dental, life insurance.
Okay.
The next question is your professional services. Yes, it's gone up a little bit. This is all dependent on, now we have the legal services. That's kind of like a moving target. If we use legal, which we can use legal quite a bit with the COVID, there's been a lot of things that's been going on with that. There's also your security, that came in a little bit higher because they had to get those certifications, so we had to go with the new company. You have your professional ed services for special education, depending on what we get in the district. It could be a moving target, you don't know. It could be a linear, it could be measured. I'm going to check that list, and then I kind of budgeted for that too.
I guess I do have a question for that. Special ed, it's special ed legal service, I guess it's budgeted at 133, forecasted at 133, but year to date it's only 32,000.
I don't know what's coming in because legal is behind in billing us. We don't always get those end results. I know there was a few things that came through Shelly's office, so I'm waiting to see before I review.
Okay.
I'm trying to be as conservative as possible. I'd rather a budget that I'm going to come in higher and come a little bit lower based on something that we say than sit there and tell you that this and then end up coming in way higher. That's my philosophy of it.
Okay.
Same with revenue. I'd rather undercut revenue and then come in higher than tell you that I'm getting some huge payment that I'm not sure I'm going to get. All right, so down in the 400 categories, this will be all of your halter, the landscaping, the snow removal. You've got SMC in there. You've got anybody that we contract out in that nature. You've got your lease and the rental of the hardware, like if you did laptops or this, that, and the other, they would flow through there. Terminating services, exterminations, and all that kind of stuff. Repairs and maintenance of the buildings. That all falls under that. That's culture. Cultures are maintenance, so that all falls in that category. The next section is going to be your 500s. This is going to be a lot of the bulk of the money that's spent in here is going to be your transportation services, which is up in the 513 categories, and 516, and 510, 513, 516, those 510 areas, those are the object codes for transportation. Then you get down to your 56, 561, and 569 are all your division, with the exception of 562 is going to be your charter. So that's always kind of looked at separately because the other stuff is like a special ed type of, mostly special ed tuition for me and them. That's rather high this year too. Next section, we go down into supplies, electricity, natural gas, bottles, you know, the bottle of gas, the meals and reimbursements, your books, supplies, everything for technology you may call in there, and then the non-capital type of equipment that we replace. If it falls under that non-capitalization, we usually use 7611, 612, or the 652.
Any idea why the electricity is up so much?
Right now, we're looking at the IGS, that's the contract assigned with that electricity contractor. Me and bigger staff are working on that, researching it. It seems a little bit higher than we thought it would come in. Don't know if it's a great deal or not until we actually sit down. But me and bigger staff are looking at
it. Okay, it looks like it's
too... I'm forecasting that the 700, because that's what they have in there for encumbrances. And the way that I'm looking at the bills, I don't exactly know if that's going to come. It's probably going to be a little lower than that, but I'd rather budget a little high from what I'm seeing. Because if you see today where we are, we're already at 403, and that's including through March. We haven't even got April, May, or June in there. It's a little scary, so we are looking at it.
Okay.
Make sure that contract is legit. Or do we need to switch? I don't know. Next section is your 700s. This is going to be all your capital equipment, which will be a lot of Scott stuff goes through this area. Typically, you wouldn't see too much of facilities go through here. They would, if they're going to do something major, it's going to be in your capital reserve fund, which is your 36. But through general fund, this is mostly Scott. Next section is your 800. This is where all your dues and fees, the bank fees, claims, the interest for the loan, you got your bond interest in here, anything from last year we go through here, or miscellaneous expenditure we go through. And the last section being your 900, this is where your bonds. Meetings this year, of course, it's very light. We've got about a $2.5 million increase in the budget for next year. So this is the year that we did the refunding, everybody, and the restructuring of all the debt. And I kind of broke it down so you can see what portion of the budget is coming in with salary and benefits, and then other than salary and benefits. And then I'm projecting we're going to go a little bit higher than where we budgeted, and the reason for that is a lot more of the COVID purchases. That we have the revenue coming in on this item. Any questions?
No, I don't think I have any other questions.
No. Now, I also put in here just for everybody's reading enjoyment is the fund balance analysis, where I think we're going to come in. After a little bit more research today, as I'm going through the book, I was trying to do both of them at the same time when I'm looking at my budget. I had projected that this surplus in the 21-22, if you look up on the screen, the total expenditures that is in our budget for 21-22 is 65 million. We have our total revenues coming in at 62.5. After I was able to adjust some of those revenues based on the money that we're supposed to be getting from ASRS and COVID money and all that, and I still have not added the FEMA to see where we come up this year, but regardless, I had that at a $3.6 million deficit, but right now it's looking at it's going to be more than a 2.5. That is relevant because in here, or I had it at a 3.3. 2023. And that $3.3 million that's sitting there as the balance of budget for 2022 is now going to change to that 2502. So when you change that number, you now have a total assigned fund balance of 3529. And this goes just a little bit. $500,000. 4.74 is where I'm saying that our fund balance is. The percentage of expenses would be 4.74. Now, in our capital, that pretty much stays consistent depending on what you spend it. This year, he did actually spend a little bit more than what he's typically spending, but you know, they're legitimate purchases, what he's purchasing. Mm-hmm. We always put the transfer of the $800,000 in there. I'm showing where we are with the tractor servicing, the turf, the D section, and the starting area modifications. That money we had set aside in there is $625, and projected capital projects at $1.4, but that brings your balance to about $2.8 million. On our budget, and I'm budgeting, I just kind of take from this 5 year when I do that. If you see up here on this line item up there, we have the $2.6 million, $2.5 million. I just kind of use this 5 year and reduce and add the $800,000, but then I'll put the $800,000 in, but then reduce what he has on his 5 year to kind of show you what kind of a running balance he has. He could spend more or less, but this is just off of what he has. Kind of gives you an idea. Still have this assigned balance in here. That's part of that fund balance sheet that I showed you. That assigned is that teaser amount that we have sitting there. Now they just had that teaser. I don't know if everyone saw the newspaper on the teasers. They decided they had a calculation error, mm-hmm. and they admitted to it. They decided to go back and now starting 7/1, the employees that are in those certain groups will now have to pay a certain percentage higher than what they've been paying. I don't know what they're going to do to the employer side. I don't know. They still say that that's probably going to jump in and bite us a little bit down the road, too, with the interest rates have been lower than what they have been. It's kind of like a wait and see. But I budget a little bit on the higher end when the schools have that for 5 years as employees.
I thought the additional contributions would actually help the employer side, but stop it from going up as much
You're
as it was going.
All right, so.
I do have a question on the balance. I can't see the taxes. What do you have the taxes at with the balance?
The taxes?
Yeah.
You're talking about the tax revenue?
No, percentage increase, if you have any increase built in for.
I don't put increase in here for you. You guys want me not to put increases in here?
Okay.
No. I leave it to where that's up to you.
Just curious.
So the projected number, So the projected numbers in the document you sent to us is what would be projected for real estate. Those first three numbers, that would be our real estate income with no increase to our current.
Well, the thing that she sent to us is for this year's forecast.
This is just for this
year.
This
okay.
Is where we are. Now, when we sit down on next Tuesday,
oh, I see.
And okay. Then I'll go ahead and send that out to you. But I only, when I present this, I have no increase whatsoever. No millage.
Okay.
Yeah.
My financial input, this is where I put my numbers in.
Yeah, no, I was just curious of the impact on the fund balance. You had that at 2.5.
There's 3154 all the way across the board. I do not increase taxes.
Okay.
I'll let you see it as it is.
Okay.
You all make your decision the way you need to. This is where we're at right now. I mean, I can show you the surplus deficit and projecting possibly $1 million. Because we have the expenditures at 60, the revenue coming in is 59. You got your preliminary. Right here, this is what you'll send it to, so we can go over just as a preamp.
Okay.
And then we just have our normal stuff going across the board. We have the deficit starting to come in. 22, 23 looks like we're going to get a little bit hit here. And then it just goes up there. Now, of course, this number over here is the same because I don't have 826, 27 on it. But once we do, we'll see how that plays it out. But yeah, I don't.
Yeah, I decide what you need to do there. Okay, so you can send that out just sometime soon.
Yeah,
I'll
send it out this week. Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, then?
Sure, yeah.
Before the weekend,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah. I guess because the workshop is scheduled for Tuesday.
For next Tuesday. Yeah. I figured I'd get it to you before, probably Thursday.
Thursday would be good.
Yeah, I have to send my update numbers. I'll send everything. You guys can have it by Thursday night. You'll have it.
Okay.
Good enough?
Yep.
All right. And then the other thing on the agenda, if anybody has any questions about it, anything that they're looking at, don't hesitate to ask. If you want to see something in more detail, just let me know.
Good.
All right, the other slide presentation I sent you in the on the update, or no, I sent it with the budget the other day, is we started going with a different broker for insurance. They're kind of looking at our entire insurance package as a whole. Governor Mifflin uses this broker as well. Look at Governor Mifflin because they do a really fine job with this, and we use Governor Mifflin help us with our payroll program, with training and stuff like that. So learned a lot from bringing her in, but a really good tool that we've been using there. But we have decided to go with Gallagher. No cost to the district. They just go out and they broker all of our insurances. They look at everything that we're paying, everything the employees are paying, and they make sure that we have the best bang for our buck. They're also, through this new insurance company, they're paying for a platform. And a lot of the companies are doing it now where they'll have their benefits coordinators. They'll have a program. They'll go into the program and they'll have somebody that they can call and discuss all their options for all their medical benefits, which is a really good thing because a lot of these vendors want to come in and talk to all of our employees all at once and you just can't do that. We'd be paying teachers extra to stay after. A lot of people don't want to sit there and listen to those presentations. But people might want to go home and have their husband or their wife sit as they're selecting their insurances, and that's what we're going to give them. It's not going to cost anything to the district. Gallagher comes in, they're also saving us $11,000 with this insurance. This insurance carrier is actually going to pay for the platform. As long as we're carrying the insurance, and we're paying for the insurance anyway, they can pay for the platform. The employees will be able to, they'll get a video, then they'll get a link. And as they're working with a coordinator, or they can work by themselves, it's really a nice program. We saw, we've gone on Tuesday, every Tuesday morning, we're on a meeting with them as we're trying to implement everything together. We sent them all the data. They have like Aflac. So what we pay for Aflac now, there's a better pricing model if you go to the corporate end. It doesn't get rid of our sales rep, so we're not hurting that guy that's been with the district for a very long time. But it makes it more efficient. It also makes it a little bit more cost effective. So this insurance right here, these people will come in. Standard was going to get rid of us anyway because we didn't have enough participation in volunteers. If we go with this company, I think that even if we stood with Standard and we kept it on the thing, I don't think enough people had the opportunity because they didn't. Nobody wants to read anything about insurance, but now they'll have that opportunity to go through and they'll have their benefits coordinated with them as they're going through, and I think they may actually feel a little bit more participating.
Okay.
But in end all, this is the one that's going to be on the agenda for you all to vote on tonight, and it is saves annually $11,000 for the business. Same coverage, everything was completely, they have all the language that goes to the contract, so it's following everything to a T. And it's offering the same thing with the volunteer on the side. A little bit better volunteer. But again, this is working with I'm completely happy with this. So that's why I brought it forward to you all to go on.
Okay. Be effective July the 1st, I assume.
Yes.
Or 22?
So anyway, right, July 1st around the corner. We have open enrollment coming up on 5/17.
Okay.
We're giving employees 3 weeks to go through all of their benefits. And that's when this whole thing will be rolled out on 5/17 for them to select for 7 months.
Yep.
I really think the employees are going to be really impressed with it. A really good program.
No, it doesn't look like we have any questions.
No.
All right, so you have any other items they want to bring up?
No.
No?
No.
So again, the budget workshop is set for next Tuesday, which is the 4th, right? Yeah. Okay. All right, well, if nothing else, then we're adjourned. Thank you.